I thought it was a cartoon. When I came in, it was before I'd gotten my first PC sound card. I didn't even realize there was voice in it. When I came in, there wasn't anyone in at that point. And I didn't even realize it was a chat where multiple people could come in. I mean, after all, it was 1993. You can get inside of here, and if you spend a lot of time in here, you begin to adapt very readily to a completely different set of environmental rules. And actually, to me, it does become another reality, a second reality or a separate one. Inside of here, we are an anonymous being, and we can conduct ourselves as such. Very slowly, the human mind will subconsciously adapt to this environment, and as it does, you don't notice the changes that are occurring while you're in here. You're not the same person in here. If we were actually in here, and all of the criteria that we have here, like there's no death, there's no injury, there's no physical pain, there's no hunger, there is with the operator, okay? But my avatar never gets hungry. It doesn't need to breathe air. If all of these things were the reality and this was the so-called fantasy part that we live in, the physical part, we would have to completely abandon all of our ideas and come up with a whole new set of coping mechanisms. This right here to me seems like the conceptualization of what heaven would be like. It causes us to exist in two worlds at the same time. You have the real world, what we call the real world, and then you have this world. The more time you spend in here, the more the line gets blurred. The addiction is—it's really. I mean, if you have an addictive personality, and you want to put it somewhere where it's safe, come on in here. You'll love it.
They tell you if you have two real friends in your life, you're really lucky. I have so many of them here that I can't imagine my life without Traveler now. There are qualities in many of these people that are admirable, and I refuse to do without Traveler because of it, because of the people. That's why we're here. And of course, my wife. I'm her biggest fan. But I get to admire her on and off, you know, Traveler.
Yeah, it seems like you got some your idols here in the room right now, which is probably why I should ask some of these questions to Fast Eddie as well. Hold on a second. Yeah, thanks for waiting there, Fast Eddie. You've probably been listening to all these questions and stuff. Just wondering if you had anything to add, perhaps your own first day that you discovered On Life Traveler, and if you had any impressions or dreams when you first approached this space. What's your personal story about it?
Okay, I saw the program on the site.com. I came in through that portal. A lot of people were coming in through MTV and NEC and some of the other larger corporate sponsors that have since left. I'm not a great typist, but that's not really the issue to me. The issue is the absolute and total sense of presence. When you come up to someone and their voice gets louder, you can tell from their voice whether they're upset or not. You know this person, or you get to know this person, and you can tell when they're tired or when they're hungry or anxious or there's something wrong in their voice. Far exceeds the ability in anything that I've ever seen, and I have looked at a lot of things. And this is a collective intellect. Every time as a traveler, if you have any your headphones on, you're going to learn something. We have had soccer games, we have had funerals, we have had weddings, we have had any number of events, live bands playing songs. This format permits any number of things, but I don't believe that any of this would be here if there wasn't really a community. There is no money in Traveler, nobody's ever made a nickel. And the bottom line is we're here because we like our friends and we want to come see our friends. The training here in social skills alone is a valid tool. I've seen numerous people come in here with problems, attitudes, issues, and begun to realize that they talk too fast, they type too fast, they're too hyper, they need to slow down, they need a little more patience. We help people with their homework, we swap recipes, we share the pain when it comes. We talk about our pets, we talk about our family, we talk about our problems and our jobs. There are so many things going on so many levels here. There are romantic interludes, there are people who've met here, some of which have gotten married. You know, it has changed many people's lives. It has very deeply changed my life. If this were gone, man, I don't know what we'd do.
I came into Traveler in the beginning of 1996, right after the very first beta. The very first beta, they allowed 50 users to come and help. And I just did miss that because I had to wait until I got my first Pentium. To be able to use Traveler. It's a P100 with 16 mega RAM, and we were talking on a 14.4 modem. So that was quite a while back. There still is no socializing application like this one. There were a lot of really big names. They probably paid through the nose for their license. I'm talking about $10,000 minimum to host a Traveler server. But they were contributing to the net, and they were also furthering their own interest. Say if they wanted to, you know, have an MTV promotion of some sort, you know, things like that. ABC Monday Night Football, you know, and they had a place for where people could come, you know, and talk about football, things like that. OnLive went out of business probably in 1998, the beginning of 1998, which is about the same time that Osgate came into being, purchased a domain in I think May of 1998, but we don't consider our official birthday until August 30th of 1998. That's when we got our first 75-user license from the powers that be that were left. And so what was left of OnLive was folded up into another company along with Electric Communities and the Palace, and they formed communities.com. And they had to go Chapter 11 also. And so once again, the online domain was off the net. And they were literally hauling computers and desks and things like that out of the building. I mean, they literally took the servers out of the building and all the old code and everything that was on the machines and shipped the machines off to other places that were, you know, where the disks were wiped and used for other companies. So a lot of old code and history like that was lost in the process. But, I mean, we didn't let it die before when that happened, and we weren't going to let it die again this time. So along came Bruce Dahmer. He got there just in the nick of time, secured ownership of the platform. So once again, the community has averted destruction.
And I think the whole internet's full of extremely lonely people. That's why we all do congregate. And there's days when we just want to be alone, but yet we want to feel somewhere. I've had lots of people go and just sit in some of these rooms that I've made, the more depressing rooms. And they just sit there for hours. The song in the room, you know, touches them in some way. Or, oh gosh, there's one room. I can't remember the name of it. But a grown man was sitting in there crying. And I'm like, what? He said, I understand this room. And, you know, that's what's fun. That's the kind of rooms I enjoy doing, are the ones that kind of, that disturb people. I enjoy those. If I get somebody upset by a piece of, you know, a work that I do, I win. I mean, I did good because they understand and it did touch them. I'm sorry, sometimes it depresses them. But sometimes it's also a place where they can go and get in touch with theirself. A lot of times two or three people will just go in there and sit and discuss the room and then end up in discussions about things that's happened in their lives. We don't always need the soda pop room where people can go in and be cheerful and happy. We're very emotional people, beings, so I think we need all kinds of rooms.
If I go near you, it'll make a bong sound. That's the same thing in real life. You know, we have this personal space. We have a certain area around us that that we feel like if somebody gets in that, we feel like they're in our personal space. So something, one of the main things that makes you feel like you're really here. And that, what that does is that, even just with the physical presence, there are other programs that have that, but they don't have the feeling of actually having personal space. A much, much more personal space here. You know you have it. If I run into you right now, you're going to feel it. You're going to know I ran into you. You're going to move, just like you would in real life. So you do feel like you have a presence, more of a presence in this program. It feels more intimate than any other program I've ever been in.
Okay, well, Online Traveler, since I've been on here, has changed my life in one big way. I have a social anxiety problem. I actually take pills for it. I go outside, I have panic attacks when I see a lot of people. When I came on Online Traveler, I had to say in the first week that I've been on here and I started socializing with people, it's made it easier for me to talk to people when I'm outside in the real world. And people are just awesome on here and they're easy to talk to. I mean, outside there's a lot of buttholes and a lot of mean people. But I learned how to open myself up to people in the world and socialize a lot better than before. And I've actually talked to my doctor, and he cut down on my medication evidence.
Before Traveler, before I got on Traveler, I was campaign manager for different candidates in politics. I give these parties at these hotels for people, and I would, you know, get them organized. I'm an organizer. And I guess you would call me, well, they refer me as, I guess I'm a leader. I've been referred to as a leader. And you're going to laugh when I tell you this. But a long time ago, when I first got on here, I was referred to as baby is a calling card. Baby's a calling card. You know what that meant? That meant put baby in a room and you're going to get a crowd. Now, why, I don't know. The biggest challenge of overcoming Traveler, I guess, was when, I had to start out. I had to start out from somewhere, and I knew that what I wanted to do when I got involved, I got to, like I said, I've worked all the servers, but my first impression was when I got to WWT, I saw the big guitar, the big entrance and all that. And then I began to get friends, and right in this room right now, I can look over there and I have a friend that's at heart over there. I've known her for 5.5 years. we got this crowd. What are we going to do with them? Let's entertain them. Let's do this. And the challenge was, can I do it? Can I give things to make these people happy? Because I just love them. I love these people up here. I don't just take them for granted. I don't take these avatars. They're not just avatars. That's people I know, and I love them. And I thought, can I really do it? And because nobody else was doing much about it, and I thought, can I really do it? Can I start giving things, and they really come, really have fun? And yep, I did. I started giving things, and let's have that dance type thing. You had to learn, we learned how to dance with these avatars and all this kind of stuff. I just started, let's have a party. Let's do this tonight. Let's start playing music. Let's do this. And they helped me. But like I told you last night in a conversation that wasn't taped, I am only as good as the people that helped me. And I had lots of help, and I have good friends. I love those people, and they help me, and they help me. Anytime I give something, that it's a success because they help me. But it was a challenge. Oh yes, it was, to start out something new and start out giving. That's a challenge. That's a big challenge. And like I told you, soon I was considered, they referred to me as a calling card, because they wherever I was, they thought, oh, that's going to be fun. If the baby's there, oh, let's go there. She's going to think of something. And I had to think of something, and that's a challenge, because I had to think of something to keep these people coming in and wanting to have more and fun. And it worked.
Yeah, it's important because we have access to so many more people out there than we have. In my case, I'm a housewife. I go to the grocery store. I might say hi to the person behind the counter and walk away with my groceries and come home. That's my interaction with people for the day, on a normal basis with just, if I didn't have a computer, let's say. But here, we have millions of people we have a chance of coming in contact with. A lot of those people are very truthful in who they say they are and this and that, and a lot of them are here, I think, on just a game type, I've met a lot of liars, let's put it that way. We just have access to so many more people. It's going to have a big play in our life.
I think the most important thing in anybody's life, first of all, to start is waking up and knowing you're alive. It's a pretty crazy world today. I have family, but my priority when I wake up in the morning is to take care of my hygiene and that stuff. But after that's done, the first thing that's on my mind is online traveler. If I'm not online traveler, I'm either sleeping or maybe watching a movie, but I'm usually on here. This is definitely a big part of my life, and this is really one of the things I live for. This is, you know what I'm saying?
I remember one time we were over in Utopia, and there were seven of us, and we were around in a circle, and we solved every single problem in the world in 7 hours. And it was a constant conversation, and everybody gave their opinion, and then one would pick up on it and go on to something else. And we had different degrees of intelligence, some very high IQs, some just normal IQs, and very, very interesting conversations going in here.
We have individual birthdays. In fact, I have a room. It's a big, pretty room, and it circles their name. It's called Birthday Bash, and it circles the name. Happy birthday, whoever it is. Happy birthday, star. Happy birthday, who's the other night, and all that. Yes, any birthday. And just like, for instance, we had a beautiful thing. It wasn't I would say it wasn't a happy thing, but the September 11th, that day, well, to do that, to make a little more thing, we made a room, had a room made, and all of the pictures, as they took, were taken from the scene, and they're all around this as a gallery. It's called Angels Cry. And we had everybody in there, I mean, they came, and we played the songs. I think every singer that sings made a song about it. And we took turns to play 10, you know, we play the different ones. But there are songs about that, and we give them a moral thing about that. And, okay, for instance, we had a person that was been on here a long time, and she passed away with cancer. We gave a memorial thing for that. I mean, we not only just give the good time things, we do the things that they're sad, but we give memorials to them. You know, about blowing up the towers. The room is very touching. It will hit you when you go in. And we had that program that night. So it's not just all happy things, but it's recognizing even the sad things.
That was a surprise party that I had no idea was coming. That was a birthday party that I didn't know they were planning. And the woman was trying to keep me out of that. I said, oh, there's a bunch of people over in that space. Why don't we go over there? And she says, oh, why don't you wait a little while and hang out over here with me? And, you know, after a while, I said, well, I'm going to go on over there. And I just, you know, head first went on in unannounced. When I went in, it was a spectacle. There were, probably 18 other avatars, and they all looked just like me. So I was pretty weirded out. It was quite cool. My wife had planned that for me. She coordinated that little event. I was in the drag strip, and we were holding the races. Now, that is something that a lot of avatars, a lot of people, took very seriously. They would get into heated exchanges about it and things like that. You know, because some people were lagged, and they saw somebody else, you know, crossing the finish line first and things like that, and they... Somebody would invariably be playing We Are the Champions, you know. So it was kind of cool.
Oh man, we even park our heads in here at night. It's kind of neat if I wake up in the middle of the night and I can just, you know, walk through the room and click on the program and Meister's laying there sleeping, you know, with his avatar asleep. It's nice to just I don't know, have that constant connection with somebody. So really, we could stay in here for days if we wanted to, but usually we log off and go ahead about our business and stuff. So, but I'd say the longest time that I've been here without logging off is probably, we had a marathon one time for a whole weekend a few years back, so I'd say about 3 days. Meister, were you around for that? I know OT was.
I believe so.
Yeah.
I was on here for at least 2 days without any sleep for the most, that's the most I ever done on here. but as far as being logged on, we stayed logged on, I believe we stayed logged on for dang near a week or better sometimes without actually logging off the program.
In my mind, this is reality. You know, albeit virtual. But okay, let's say we hold church here in Traveler. We have, you remember how we were talking about the carnival where we had different events, storytelling or drag races or what have you. You know, there are people that I've known in Traveler for 7 years, and that certainly is community. Because we allow no abuse, as opposed to complete anarchy, we have a rule set. And certainly that is the beginning of civilization. That is the beginning of culture. There are a lot of people who come in here seeking answers. Hey, I'm trying to do this, Has anybody else done it? I mean, it's a real mecca for minds, like no other.
Well, we were playing one night over in Repair. Alan had just put that room up a couple of months before, and there was a group of us over there. There was 8 of us, I think. And all of a sudden, we decided that we were playing Truth or Dare around the fireplace on the rug. We're all sitting on the... Ooh, sorry, cop. We were sitting all around the rug, and we were playing Truth or Dare. And all of a sudden, Tanami says, how about if we have a seance? So we all went over to this one little table that's beside a bed, and we're all sitting around the table, and we're having this seance, believing that we're holding each other's hands. And looking at a candle. And that didn't work out too well, so then we decided we were going to have an exorcism. We had Zeke lay down on the bed and shut his eyes, and we were doing all these exorcism things, you know, saying different things and making our avatars go back and forth toward him and things like that. And we had quite a lot of fun doing that for, about 2 hours, yeah.
I'm known on Traveler as Steve. It happens to be my real name. I'm not very imaginative with names. I hail from Australia, Brisbane and Queensland in particular. I've now been doing this church service in Traveller for just over 4 years. Participation is very good, and quite frankly, I don't care if there's one person in the room or the room is full. I suppose I do have a format. I start off with the Lord's Prayer, and I use the Lord's Prayer because most people will know it, if not other than just their childhood. But the Lord's Prayer is a very important prayer, in my opinion. But it can be abused. We have a tendency to just rattle off without actually thinking what the Lord's Prayer is actually saying. So yes, I mean that's the first thing that we do. The second thing, the next stage we go into is I will ask anybody if they need prayer. I will always get messages sort of saying, you know, my child is sick, you know, could you pray for me? So we will spend a couple of minutes in prayer for people that need it. It could be themselves, their family members or friends. As far as the sermons are concerned, the teaching, it's very, very basic. It's basically gospel. It's basically what God has done for mankind in the form of Jesus. I don't go through any depth because, quite frankly, I don't know it. My main focus is just basically telling people what Jesus did for them. I will then, towards the end, I will read. I will explain how somebody becomes a Christian, and I will give a very quick background as to what it means to be a Christian, and then I will read a prayer for those that want to say it, that they can repeat this prayer after me, and it's a prayer of salvation. I suppose the whole focus of the Bible is basically saying, is if we were to summarize, the question I suppose the Bible summarizes is, are you ready? Are you ready for the second coming, for when Christ returns? And I suppose in all of my messages, that's the main focus. If I was to focus on anything, that's what I would focus. The difference that, you know, the choices that have to be made. Because whether we believe God or not, as I said, God is either real or he's not. If he is real, he has said through his word that his son Jesus is going to return to judge all mankind. And I don't want any of my friends, any of my family members, not to be with me in heaven. So that, I suppose, is the most predominant feature of my sermons, if I was to summarize.
All of us regulars can't imagine why this isn't propagated around the world. Well, certainly this, everything we do here is global by its very nature, but why aren't there more Traveler servers all around the world? Why isn't everybody doing this? I can't imagine. Yeah, I can understand why big business doesn't really want back this, but I can't understand why the general populace won't. I think it's mainly because most people don't know about it. But yeah, it is intimidating for a lot of newbies. You know, they come in and it's just too real. I don't think the problem is that it's surreal. I think that it's too real. They're intimidated. These are people who came from the text chat world, and now, you know, they feel actually confronted. You know, even though that isn't the atmosphere, they feel invaded. You know, they feel like people are actually in the room, or they're expected to behave a certain way or things like that. It's too real for them.
I really thought these faces were made on your kitchen table with little cardboard cutouts and stuff. And then there was some way that they had little cameras. I mean, I had it all figured out in my head how they were done. Of course, I had no clue that there's 3D software out there and you had to put textures on models and blah, blah, blah. But that's how I learned. And I would probably have never built another one after the first one if people didn't like it so much. You know, the encouragement that everybody gave me with the space and how much they loved it is, you know, what made room number two. So room number two led to room number 60. Uninvited would probably be the most shocking. In fact, I think they renamed it on me without my permission at one of the other servers. But it was called Uninvited. And it happened that I was seeing somebody here online that was very, very, very jealous. I mean, this man, if I could just be sitting here quiet and he would be accusing me of being in messages with people that I had absolutely no clue who they even were. I was smothered by this person. And so the song Uninvited, I listened to it one day. I'd heard the song forever, but one day I actually listened to it and had to build a space for it. Whenever you come into the room, you actually land in a little cage with keys that float around the cage. And it represented being caged, and all I really had to do was say go away to this person, but I couldn't. And so it was right there in reach. I just couldn't get it out. If you looked up the cage, which very few people actually look up when they land in a room. I like to put things up in the air for those people that do like to explore. But if you look up, you'll see this type of demon thing holding the rope of this cage. Along the walls, you'll see a woman screaming up into the sky. This room was one of the first ones that Traveler had ever seen like this. They were more into the social rooms. I had people, asking me, what is this room about? And I wouldn't tell nobody, you know, because it was my emotion that I needed to put out. And it was fun. It's fun. It's fun to sit there and put on a different avatar that they don't know and just kind of sit there in the shadows and listen to their, you know, their discussions on the room. And, oh, boy, they come up with a bunch of different explanations for the room. Very few people ever really understood it. But it's fun. It's fun.
With some rooms, especially the Fractal one, that's got special meaning to a few people. The old Doom rooms, which I've made, you know, they hold nostalgic value. This avatar I'm wearing actually is a remake of the original pink thing from Doom, which of course was a two-dimensional sprite, and this is more like a three-dimensional flesh of it. And we had some fun making this, I can tell you. Me and one of the other avatar designers, when I actually first made this, it was about 50 foot tall, and we took some really amazing pictures of it. Because it just took up the entire room. Yes, some people do like particular rooms, and you'll find that what they'll do if they're a new user, if they see one of your rooms and they particularly like it, they'll set that as what's called their home world. So as whenever they want to travel up, it'll take them into it. Some people like this one because they find it calming, but other people hate it because it just drives them insane. Triangles everywhere. Lots of people like that because it's very mathematical, and there's a lot of beauty in mathematics. If you think about it, we're all running off mathematics at the moment. Everything within Traveller is running off mathematics of some description. So, you know, when you've got a mathematical equation which is expressed, someone who is into mathematics or into fractal design is going to like that room more than someone who isn't, you know, because they will get a deeper meaning from it than other people would. That's why most of my rooms are, well, all my rooms are quite varied. You know, there's no real theme to my rooms. They all tend to be, you know, totally different designs or impressions of thoughts which I've had. What the online aspect of my personality is really an expression of what my mind cannot express within the real world. The rooms I've created and the avatars I've created are ideas and thoughts made solid, or semi-solid, because you can fly through them, in a virtual world. I consider them to be completely different in the ways, you know, the real world's a real world, and the virtual world isn't a replacement or isn't really an escape. It's more of an expression of what my mind cannot convey in a physical, you know, physical presence.
I don't know how to explain this. This is really difficult. Well, if you look in the floor, this room still gets to me, in fact, so. If you look down, you'll see an angel face down in what's supposed to be ice. There's a stairway over behind you. This song was made for a friend of mine who basically had to in the relationship because they thought they were dying for surgery. Anyway. People perceive it differently.
What inspires you to build a room?
I build it to solve a problem I'm having at that time. Like I said, this room here was built because somebody I really, really cared about basically said goodbye because they thought they were dying and they didn't want to go to hell. I mean, you know, so I don't know. It helped to relieve that sadness that I was having by being able to display it instead of just bottling it all up inside. So, I mean, this room has served its purpose. If it does go, I'm going to be sad because I do like still come play in it. You know, but it did what it was supposed to do for me. I built it because I needed to build it, not because it needed to exist.
How did you feel when you heard Steve DiPaolo was lecturing about your work?
I'm not good at a lot of things. I'm really not. And to actually know that I'm being discussed in colleges all over the country, yeah, it really does make you feel good. It makes you feel warm, makes you feel successful at something. Even if it's just something that can go poof in a heartbeat. I mean, that's the only sad thing for me is that all this work I've done, except for on my own hard drive, I mean, all I've had to do is just strip it right off the server and everything that I've done is gone. That's the only depressing thing. It's not lasting artwork. All it is lasting in people's minds. So that's another reason why I like to do these type of rooms. They do put an imprint on people that they do touch. I mean, it's there forever that way.
This is one of the original avatars, all right? And I started using this avatar and had it painted the way I have it now. I don't know. I guess it just, it. I think it reflects me. I'm soft. I'm very sensitive. I think I'm naive in a lot of ways. And so I think that this avatar best expresses how I am. Plus, I have white hair, so that, you know, kind of does the trick for me.
I notice your name is Van Gogh. What kind of avatar do you think Vincent Van Gogh would wear?
Oh, now. What kind of avatar? That's a hard one because there are many. I think he would choose the box. There's a speaker box. I think he might choose that. And I think that the type of room he would use would be an extremely, I think it would be a very abstract, bright, extremely colorful room. It would not, I don't think it would have, I think it would have little structure, actually. Boy. Anyway, thanks for listening to me blabber and everybody else. I just wanted to make sure that the art part was definitely...
Many years ago, I played in a band, and we did a Zeppelin cover. I was struck by a truck. Lost all of my memory. When I came back from the recovery of the hospital, that I remember that was another Zeppelin, and that's the only memory I had is Zeppelin. So Zeppelin became my life.
No, not really. A house is a house, a road is a road. I don't tend to give the real world a great deal of what's the word? It doesn't really interest me very much. I like to stay in. Occasionally I go out, you know. I went out one day and my frame rate dropped to 5, so I come back in. It's a joke, by the way.
You know, for some reason, though, in here it seems like the human faults are even more magnified, because the only thing there is to actually do in this environment is to deal with yourself in an inner way that goes way beyond what you do out in society. I'm not sure if mature is the word. I think, but that's close. I certainly have always looked at things outside of Traveler like I do in here. I think that's what attracted me so much to this program. Outside of here, I'd probably do that behind the mask that everybody has to wear out there. I probably am like it, and a lot of people are. But outside of here, the only thing it's really done is that I have to really concentrate to be the same person, or even nearly the same person, or to readapt to the outside world again. Whenever I am outside of Traveler, because I'm in here so much. I became extremely ill, and I've been in here for almost 5 years. And I didn't really plan it that way, but it happened, and I had an opportunity to set up this server to try to preserve this program and to magnificent work that so many people have done. And it just so happens that it worked out along with an illness I've had to deal with. And I think that when I get fully recovered and everything and I go out into the world again, I definitely will not see it the same as I did before.
I'm very creative. And if I wanted to dye my hair pink, well, then my avatar's hair can be pink, too. I mean, yeah, the emotions of the avatars, you know, you can make them sad and mad and happy. So people do know what you're feeling. Well, because before I was a bird, and I like to be a, you know, a person. Because the bird is pretty rough looking, so, and I'm not a bird, so, but if I want to be, I can be.
Well, I've seen, you know, lately, some of the traveler artists like Dominic, really nice guy, are wanting to do full-bodied avatar. I think he should have the ability to do so, but at the same time, I hate him. I hate him because it ruins the scale of the room. Traveler has always had these avatars that were like heads, you know, and so the rooms were all, again, we were observing a scale to the rooms. And then when you introduce these full-bodied avatars, that changes the scale of the room. There are a lot of people who came in from Active Worlds or Black Center, something like that, where they all had full-bodied avatars, and they thought that was the norm. They'd come in here, and of course, they'd pick those first. And you'd have a bunch of people, you know, with full-bodied avatars, you know, flying around. You know, it would take up more space than the average avatar. There would be a lot more incidents of accidental bonking and stuff like that going on as a natural result. You know, I like the work. I like the work that he's doing. He's done some really cool avatars, like the hot dog you're wearing, but I don't like it when it really throws off the scale of the room. I think that's rather intrusive. Absolutely, and they're not as expressive as the avatars we enjoy now. You know, I have a mouth that lip syncs when I speak. The avatars we use traditionally are very emotive, and they were designed to be that way from day one. The community is pretty much going to decide for themselves what they want. You know, I think there are other people who think the way I do, and people are going to decide what they want simply by choosing what avatar they wish to wear. And it'll all come out in the wash.
This the default avatar as well?
You look like the default avatar on my laptop. Oh wait, we got it now. You look like the Tiki Man.
Yeah, sometimes I wear this.
So why do you wear this avatar?
Well, I'll usually have my name changed. I'll be Smitty. I'll change it to a guy named Smitty. And it's just for fun, you know what I mean? I'll run around because you never see anybody named Smitty. It's just a fun one. Some friends of mine, they don't like the way this avatar looks. They think it's ugly, so I'll color it up as ugly as I can and fiddle fart around and tell jokes. And it's just a fun thing to play with, you know. Everybody picks on Smitty, you know, and so we'll just kid around with it mainly. It's just something fun to do. I don't know, Smitty's usually a... maybe he's another personality I have. I don't know. I don't do a whole lot. I'll just put this avatar on. I'll usually morph the voice a little bit, and I'll go up to some of my friends, and I'll tell them that their avatar looks horrible, or they don't even know how to paint their avatar, or, you know, I'll tell them it sucks, and I'll say, you know, I'll just give them a hard time, and they'll say, oh, that's just that Smitty, you know, or they'll, you know, or they won't know. I did it one time to somebody. I dressed up as Smitty, and they didn't know it was me, and I really had them quite riled up. It was pretty fun.
Do your other avatars change your personality as well?
No, yeah. It's not really a different personality, it's just me having fun. You know, it's not like I put on an avatar and I change my personality, you know, I morph into that person. You know, 99% of the time I'm just Dominic, you know. I'll change the avatar and kid around with somebody and have some fun, but it's just Dominic behind the avatar.
I never come in here with the attitude that everything is going to be hunky-dory, shall we say. Therefore, there's been a bit of hell on Traveler. We went through a period in 99 into 2000 where there was a free speech war in here among some of the users, and it was felt on all of the servers. And some of the servers were ruined and had to be completely redone, et cetera, et cetera. I would say that's a formal tale in here.
Have your experiences as a traveler made you more careful about how you talk to people?
Not because of my experiences in
these different forums where people could go, and they were web-based forums where people would go and slam each other in text. You know what? People normally get along when they're talking in voice. They used to say the really harsh stuff in text on that board. And a lot of that had to do with a fight between one particular user and one particular server op who hasn't been running a server for a long time, and they just had at it all the time. They had at it in world, and they had at it on the web-based forums and all that. And I wouldn't call it a freedom of speech war so much as these two guys were pretty much the ones sparring, and everybody else was just kind of sitting on the sidelines watching to see what happened.
I've had several dreams about being in Traveler. The one that I found that was the most fun happened during the free speech wars. And of course I mentioned the servers being damaged. And this one night I had gone to bed and I started having this dream about someone going into Oz's computer, into his server, and his avatar just zoomed right up to them. They could see it on their screen instead of the text and what have you. And it said that you have 10 seconds to get out of my server, and then your computer will blow up. And then I woke up.
See, a lot of people here don't even remember the quote-unquote avatar wars. There was this huge donut-shaped avatar, and I mean it was absolutely massive. That would span the width of the old gate entrance space. And when you do like something like that, just turning the avatar would bonk you know, tens of people at a time. So that was abusive, you know, just by its very creation. Some kid came in, and after he got done bonking everybody and was warned not to, you know, you get that sometimes. You get the adolescents in here who are always toeing the line, and so then he dressed up his avatar painstakingly to look like mine. Then he went to his profile and had it to read exactly like mine, and I didn't mind that. You know, I wasn't really worried about it. People in the room could hear my voice and they'd know which one was me. Then he went to another room and started raising hell. And yeah, the only time somebody ever tries to assume somebody else's identity is to, you know, perpetrate something bad. There's never been any good come of it.
I would wake up in fear. And then as I had children and I started reading them storybooks, I discovered how the spots came into my dreams. One of the storybooks that I was reading to them was one, we're getting attacked here. Hang on a minute. I can't figure out what I'm running into.
KB, did you get rid of that dude for us, man?
If you keep stopping people, I'm going to have to call Oz, and you don't want me to do that. Sorry. Go ahead. If you keep bumping into people, I'm going to have to tell Oz, okay? Well, just stop it.
Yeah, just, yeah, that's all right.
Thank you.
You're welcome. I'm sorry for interrupting you. Go ahead.
Sorry.
Oh, no.
Okay, this is getting ridiculous. Okay, I'm back. I'm sorry. Should I start over?
And you know I told you about, yes, there is hackers. Yes, we've been hit several times. But does it get us down? No. We got a backup server. We can be back up and nothing flat because Star sees to that. He makes the servers and we got it. And we're, like I said, we try to be up 24/7, and that's a challenge because sometimes, it's a challenge to keep things going. I like a challenge. Life is a challenge, and if you don't, you only get out of life what you put in it. And boy, I'm getting a lot out of life. I love it. I love life. I love people. And I love to be on Traveler.
Self-competition and jealousy and stuff that doesn't need to be here. I mean, come in, talk, have fun, play with the graphics, and stop getting so dang personal and hateful. That's what it is. I mean, there's three great servers out there, and people used to be able to travel back and forth from server to server and have a good time. Then it becomes to where a lot of people feel like, oh, well, that server operator is going to be upset if I go over here, so I better stay here. And that's where it all starts. Who has the most people on the server? That's the best server. It didn't used to be like that years and years ago. But it's turned into that, and that's a shame. It needs to be under one roof. I wish that Bruce would see that and somehow manage to just give Traveler one big server, and that not have all these little, or at least not have them all on the same destination page. You know, let each server deal with their own destinations page so you don't see that competition right there in black and white. That would take care of a lot of it and get rid of a lot of the problems in this community.
These internet programs, you will always have the person that comes in that wants to be a pain in the butt. We have the ability in Traveler to remove people. Now, the server operators or one of the techs can do it. They now know that not to remove somebody unless I ask it, unless they become very, very annoying, not only for myself, but for the people that are listening. So there was one particular time when this young person came in, and he was a real pain in the butt, and I just quickly sent him a message saying, look, you know, we're having a church service, feel free to stay. But, you know, if you're going to continue on being a pain, you know, I'll have you removed. Anyway, he basically sat through the whole service, which goes roughly around about an hour. And in the end, he came up to me and he asked me a question. Basically the question is, you know, how do I know that God exists? For anybody to answer that, in my opinion, is almost an impossibility. because the relationship that we have between ourselves as individuals and God is a very private one. So it wouldn't matter what I said to him, giving him my own experiences between myself and God, it really wouldn't answer the question. And interestingly, it came to me as an explanation, I suppose. And basically what I said to him was, picture yourself as a person that's a software developer, and you have just created something like The Sims, and you've created these individuals, but you can actually interact with these individuals. You can come in from your real life and go into your software life that you've created, and they can see you and you can see them. And I could see this as a good example of the relationship between us and God. God has this, he can, excuse me, he can move within his own realm, but he was at the very beginning able to come and go into our world and his world. And it seemed to hit the nail right on the head for him. He could get an understanding of what my relationship with my Creator is, and it was truly a wonderful time. Now, he never came back again. His parting comment to me was that, you know, you've given me so much to absorb. Now, one of the things, one of the huge drawbacks between a ministry that I have here on the internet as opposed to in real life is that I can never meet the people that I speak to. I can't touch them. I can't, you know, have a face-to-face with somebody. And he never came back, and I don't know whatever happened to him. But the main thing that was important in the whole thing was that I didn't preach to him. I gave him an honest answer, and he listened. Now, keep in mind, this was a person, and I don't know how old this person was. This was a person that came in that wanted to disrupt the church service. He left wanting to know more.
Well, what would I do if Traveler disappeared tomorrow? I would just sit down and cry, if you want to know. I'll be honest with you. I would sit down and cry. Because there's nothing like it, and I don't want to go to a text chat program. I don't want to text and write and type. You can't feel the emotions. You can't hear their voice. You can't tell if they're sad, they're glad, they're happy. You want to hear them talk. You want to hear their expression. You want to know if they're mad, they're glad, and they're happy. Take Traveler, and I'd cry. I would. I'd cry. Because if we lost Traveler, I'd lose a lot of friends that I dearly love. I mean, I've grown to love a lot of them. And when I say love them, I would go out of my way to help them and do anything. I talk to a lot of them on the phone, long distance. I don't think a thing about picking up and calling. So, maybe lost, because if you'd been doing something for 5.5 years and it fold up and you'd lose all the contact of some friends you've known, and I don't just have 5, 15, I got bunches, a lot of people. Wouldn't you want to just sit down and cry? Oh, I would. I'm honest about it. And I hope that it don't fold up. I will be doing everything we can to keep this server running. I mean, this server's going to run, and we're working and keeping it. And we hope nothing ever happens to Trevor. I do.
I would be hurt. I have a lot of friends on here. I would be quite lost. This is like a second life to me. After I take a shower, brush my teeth, eat my lunch, I mean, this is where I spend most of my day. I mean, this is a big part of my life. People on here are like my family. And I've only been here for 3 weeks.
Well, first of all, let me say this, that I come in here to better myself. So I leave my name and my reality, you know, in a chair over there somewhere. So I try and be a better person. I try and raise the standard. Secondly, let me say that I have this weird idea that somewhere down the line in the future, someone will be able to extract your entire conscious state and plunk it on the internet so that I could be sitting here talking to my great-great-great-grandchildren, telling them about, you know, how we used to have gasoline engines and telephones that had cords on them and things like that. Even after the physical is gone, that a transference to the conscious state, a Tron scenario, could be possible. But, and I also want to say that between being able to hear someone's voice and seeing the animation, the reality of a body language and of your own space, is so much more powerful than anything I've ever seen anywhere else. I don't know. I think it's possible that somewhere down the road, we may find a way to have a bot emulate our avatar. I don't know. There's all kinds of possibilities here. New things happening every day. It's strange.
Yeah, it certainly is strange. I find that story really interesting. What comes to mind for me is that Edison, just before he made a machine, or tried to make a machine to contact the dead, but he died before making it. That's one reason we thought of this question, because he was trying to deal with spirituality in the telecommunications environment. Do you have any more thoughts about that?
Tough one. You got me on that, but I'd like to think that, I mean, there have been a few travelers that we know have died, and they will be remembered for a long time. Rooms have been made in there, you know, in eulogy to them. You know, we'll keep pictures of their avatars as we remembered them. But as far as communing with the dead, I don't know. Maybe they get an internet connection in heaven. Maybe we'll be seeing some of these people.